Having met Padraig, his skipper and chef for the night, Clarubi stood on the deck and looked to wave goodbye to Evene once more. The bench on which she'd been sitting was empty. Nobody was outside the Hanged Man's Inn any longer. Bleh. Up the Grand Canal they slowly beat. Padraig turned out to be a source of fascination to Clarubi, who admired, among other things, his seaweed quilted jacket, his frequent habit of saying like as if, his formidable knowledge of Kildare lore and history. Though Clarubi wished to grasp the perplexities of Padraig's character, he would not learn that night, or for that matter any other night, that the skipper was the kind of middle-aged Irish Catholic for whom the definition of sexual intercourse was the missionary position, with the male on top. The kind of father who couldn't make head nor tail out of what his children found amusing in a show as preposterous as SpongeBob SquarePants. The kind of male who wore shoes he bought 30 years ago, shoes in which he'd run a marathon. In 12 years' time, a pulmonologist at the Mater Misericordia University Hospital would diagnose Padraig with stage 3 adenocarcinoma of the left lung. Within months he'd die of respiratory failure. The doctor, on the other hand, would live another 9 years before dying in a head-on collision with a motorcyclist. I see you haven't any dietary requirements or the like, Padraig called to Clarubi as the barge passed through Salins. In that case, we have a few yolks we can play around with. Schputz and a bit of edge for sure, but for mate, we'll be having trout, veal, gouchons, sausages, or a coupage peony as we'd say in these parts. The pick's yours. Clarubi, standing alongside Padder at the helm of the barge, surveying the denizens of Salins within eyeshot, repeated softly the magical word he'd just heard Padraig utter. Gouchons, he said, not understanding its meaning but appreciating its oral texture. Begad, gouchons it is so. That night Clarubi sat down to a generous portion of boiled potatoes saturated in Kerrygold butter, a whole head of fresh broccoli, 6 large chicken gouchons, breaded and fried on the same day by Padraig himself, and a pint of milk. The chicken was so delectable that the absence of such a food on Tupato made him feel cheated, and when coupled with the fleeting memory of Evene's unique personality, the chicken made him wistful and lacrimose. Luckily Padraig was at hand to perk up his spirits. The two of them played cards and drank cans of Tuberg until the early hours of the morning. Though Padraig hadn't a notion what Clarubi was saying, they both enjoyed each other's company immensely. Clarubi's execution brought moderate sunshine and mild gusts of wind. The barge left Inchicore at dawn, reaching Grand Canal dock around noon. Clarubi was at a loss as to what he should do in Dublin. Quite frankly, he wished that his death could have come sooner. After navigating himself out of Grand Canal Quay, however, he looked down Ringsend Road and told himself that he'd try to enjoy his last few hours as a living organism. He span eastward and walked towards Bridge Street, crossing the River Dodder and keeping straight till he reached Seanmore Park. There he learned that Seanmore was a councillor and a TD before assuming the position of Lord Mayor of Dublin between 1962 and 1964. Well, Clarubi couldn't be entirely sure. The limestone rock on which this information was printed was misleading, for it said 1962/1964. Clarubi was unsure whether this meant that Moore held the keys to the city in 1962 and 1964, or during those 3 years. He stared at the rock for so long and with such focus that a child, approaching to retrieve a Schlitter, felt disquieted by Clarubi's vacant expression. Eventually he came to his senses and realized that his ruminations were futile. He exited the park by its southeasternmost entrance and walked towards the Irish Sea. On a drab excuse for a beach he stared across at 2 striped cylinders in the distance, alongside which were 4 smaller poles and an assortment of buildings. It comforted him to see nature, humanity, and industry all coexisting within the same sungrey tableau. On his planet there was a tendency among its populace to denigrate industrial buildings, or machinery of any kind. They claimed that industry was a repulsive generator of falsities, on which, were to Paytonians not careful, their future generations would subside until their mechanical mechanics consequently corroded, and the entire planet became a wasteland. One of Plerubi's earliest cans was enclosed with the ostensible verity, "Industry is good for you." It was due to his manifest unpopularity at the time that such a subversive comment could go undetected by the authorities. With the afterimage of the Poolbeck generating station lingering in his brain, Plerubi made for Sandymount railway station. While aboard a Dublin area rapid transport locomotive to Shankill, he saw a lady whose furry leotard reminded him of Zerpotty tigers, a life form native only, to his knowledge at least, to southern Tupeto. The universe, he concluded, was a small place. In Shangana Park, he climbed aboard his death pod, which was waiting for him in the middle of a Gaelic Athletic Association pitch. Surprisingly, the Dunleary Rathdown County Council only received 4 complaints regarding its unwelcome presence in the area that day. Once inside, he retrieved his space suit from his suitcase and put it on. All throughout the pod's launch, Plerubi was calm. In fact, even as he passed beyond the Karman line, 100 kilometers above the Earth's surface, he could say that he was without fear. Yet when Tupeto became clear on the horizon, and grew significantly in size with each minute, his body pushed back in his seat. He felt his hair go cold. His heart leapt against the thick insulation of his spacesuit. What was worse, as the pod began to enter Tupeto's orbit, it also began to shed its parts. Sirens, lights, warnings came on. This was a standard pod, remember, and though it was programmed to fail, its makers had never intended for this to be the case. Besides, the correctional services of Tupeto thought the cinematic alarum would add to the punishment of the executionee, and they were right. The pod moved into Tupeto's mesosphere. The speed at which it was hurtling caused its walls to ignite. Plerubi began to sweat, on account of both his fear and the heat. He thought about dying many times in his life. Yet in spite of his protestation that he was not afraid of death, he now wished for another chance to live. He thought of the time he had left until his pod hit the ground. A minute at best. There was no time left but for the essentials, the emphatic thoughts, the opinions of a lifetime. He rid his mind of everything and asked himself what he wanted to say. No one would hear his thoughts or learn about them later. Nobody would know what went through his mind before he died. And yet, for himself, he wanted a concise summation of his existence. Not so much a moral or an aphorism, as an impressionistic brushstroke. A disintegrating blurry photograph. A humble truth. Fuck.